we have a gentleman here, Joseph Turner. He's running for Assembly. What Assembly position are you running for?
District 1
Assembly here. We need to get our help. We need to get out. We need to help these people. We need to actually get constitutionals back into office. So I'd like to thank Joseph and his wonderful wife, Kara, for coming out. And we'd like to let this gentleman speak for a few minutes so he can speak to constituents and tell you what it is he stands for and the things that he believes he can promote to help our country and our state again. So can I please get a moment of forwardness up here to watch Joseph, please? Thank you.
Hosting this panel is allowing me to do that.
I think you got 25 feet.
Yeah, you have to stand up from the speaker for the feedback. So, the reason I'm running for Assembly, which is in the Assembly 1st District, which is the northeastern part of the state, it's not in Sacramento County, part of Placer, Nevada, Sierra, Lassen, Loomis, Modoc, Siskiyou, Shasta. It's a difficult task. Right now we have the incumbent State Senator Brian Dolly's wife who's running for the vacated Assembly seat, and the nepotism is being called and complained about within the district, and people aren't liking that.
They're coming out here, I'm sorry.
Okay. And I decided to run before because it was going to be an open seat. I don't have a lot of money. I'm not an incumbent spouse. I am a man who cares deeply about our Constitution and our liberty. And in short, what I really want to do is I want to make California the premier battleground state in the Union. I want to see Americans across the Union dump hundreds of millions of dollars into state, local, and federal elections in California. And I also want to see anybody who can get elected off of that premise challenge the unconstitutional actions of both California and the federal government within the state legislature.
Good.
So if I could run, the main thing I want to do is I want to inform our constituents about the legislative inquiry process. Anybody who's been in the military, they've heard before, write your congressman. The congressman will open up an investigation. The same thing can happen at the state level with your state senator and your state assembly. Your state senators and assemblymen have the ability to demand records, communications, etc., under the purview of their constituents who have a complaint or a grievance with the state. Everybody needs to know that. We need a state legislator who's going to do that proactively to try to force transparency. You can't make promises of transparency as, oh, we're going to work together to make the government more transparent. No, you're not. You're going to get stonewalled, you're going to get lied to, you're going to get misdirected. You have to use the tools that you have. The legislative inquiry process is a huge tool that has to be used and all the constituents need to know about. Another thing I really want to do, I want to give teeth to all of the lawsuits that are going on, especially like that ammunition de facto ban that's going to go into effect next month. You can't purchase ammunition unless you have a registered caliber. A registered rifle or pistol with that exact caliber, you can't purchase outside of that. That's a de facto ban. That's worse than it's like a tax stamp, but no. Failing. Poll tax. I'm sorry. Poll tax. And it's worse than a poll tax. And that needs to go away. Blatantly unconstitutional. What has to happen is legislators need to work with these private interest groups who advocate for our rights, specifically for our rights and constitutionality, not just a special project like what the Sierra Club does. We have to address our rights and our rights that are secured by the Constitution. So our rights to keep and bear arms. Arms are weapons of offense and armor for defense or protection of the body. That's the 1828 definition of it. It's very simple. It's very specific. It's all illegal. So what we need to do is we need to try to pass legislative remedy, which is what I'm referring to it as a legal standing. You try to pass the legislative remedy, the state legislature will reject it. They will absolutely reject it. And that should establish harm, further harm, or standing for the legislators who sign on to that remedy to to join those lawsuits. And when you join a lawsuit as an elected official or as a governing body, it includes all of your constituents. So if you have an assemblyman who signs on to a Gun Owners of America or an NRA or a CERCA lawsuit, you suddenly have 500,000 or so more plaintiffs onto that case. It makes the case much stronger. And it also needs to be worded to where there is a proper correction in the legislative remedy bill that's proposed to even help further along the court case. And that's one thing I really, really want to do. I cannot promise to say, we want less regulations, we want to be more business friendly, we want to do all that. You can't. That's a lie, it's nonsense, it's a trick. And the only person who would really benefit would be the person who would be elected in that position. That's not what I want to do. I don't care if I get ousted in a year or if they kick me out of the assembly after I cause too much problems for them. I'm medically retired. My body hurts. I'm slow every morning. You can ask my wife. I have a heck of a time getting up to do things early, and traveling also beats me up. But I want to do it because I want to secure our liberties. I want to fight for it the same way we did overseas. Many of us here who are combat veterans, we know what it's like to sit lackadaisically and stare off into the distance while our loved ones wonder, well, what's wrong with mommy or what's wrong with daddy? It's a horrible feeling. But we need that in the legislature. We need to fight. Everybody's moving. California has a huge exodus going on. Wages and jobs are leaving. Not only that, people are moving, especially up north. Everybody's moving. Everybody knows somebody who's moving. We don't want to move. This is our home. We want to stay and fight. And the theme of my campaign is fight or flight. And the biggest thing is I'm the underdog. But I will absolutely do what I say and say what I do. And there's no question about what I will do. If you ask me, I will tell you. I will be honest. If there's something I cannot do, I will be honest and I will tell you about that. But the biggest thing is I need help from surrounding counties, from surrounding states, anywhere that it is legal to donate to a campaign to help get the word out, because this is happening in the summer. There's only 60 days. The primary is August 27th. It was cut short very, very quickly on purpose. And then the general election will be November 5th, I believe. So I need to try to raise money. I hate asking for it, but it's unfortunately it's part of the game you play because you have to be able to get the word out. But even better than that, word of mouth. If all you can do is just share some, come to my Facebook page, it's Joseph Turner for Assembly. Joseph Turner for Assembly, District 1. TurnerForAssembly.com. If you can come to those, if you can share those, if you can't donate to help the cause, that's fine. Just help spread the word, especially to anybody that you know up north, and ask them to spread it. It's an insurgency campaign that I'm going to be running, and we have to be able to take it to the status quo and to the establishment. And I've already done that already. I'm on the California Republican Party Platform Committee. Current State Senator Brian Dolly, who was then Assemblyman Brian Dolly, while he was running for State Senate, he endorsed my opponent. I was able, within the California Republican Party delegates, I was able to secure that seat and win that internal election. So I'm already not liked on a certain level, and I want to continue that fight to take it forward. And I really appreciate anybody who can share the word and participate and join this, because I want to get the legislators around the union to join this type of platform and this type of, it's a universal model of an approach to use the legislative inquiry process to submit for legislative remedy and to join lawsuits and get the union involved where it's supposed to be, and also, in turn, do the same thing when the union is wrong and they're overstepping their enumerated powers. And I appreciate the time in here. Thank you very, very much for allowing us to come down.
Thank you so much. Joseph Turner here, his wife Kara, wonderful people, great people, wonderful patriots, trying to help this country move in a more positive direction. So again, if you can share the Facebook page, we'll link it today to make sure we know the names, we get a card or at least information. And if you're able to make at least a dollar donation, doesn't matter. At this point, I think pennies add up. So if you're capable, share, spread the word, and do what you can. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you. So we've got Mr. Leo Lyon Zagami here, your boy Jared Flores here. He is the one who's helped finance all this wonderful event. He paid for the food. We have Empty Stomach Catering, my buddy Maurice out of high school, this gentleman right here. He got us our wonderful food. Thank you everybody who came out. I really appreciate you all. So I'm now going to hand over the microphone to our speaker, Mr. Zagami. And feel free to, like I said, get some food, get some drinks, sit back and chill if you could. Think of some questions that you'd like to ask so that we either have a break, or as you're going, if the questions become too much, throw your hand up and politely wait. And if he can, he'll include your questions in his presentation. So he's going to try to work them in there. So if we can, there's something that you have to ask and it isn't really fitting in, write it down and remember it because we're going to get to it at the end, okay? So thank you very much, and let's give a round of applause for Leo Zagami.
First of all, it's an honor to be here in the VA Post for this first speaking engagement here in the U.S. And maybe not all of you know my work. So first of all, I would like to know who knows my work by maybe lifting their hands. Who knows my work? Okay, so the vast majority seems to know already my work. Well, what I'm going to be doing today is a description really of the reality of conspiracy, not the myths, neither the legends, but only what can be actually verified, because it's a reality, of course, which is very uncomfortable for a lot of people, but it's a reality that I have talked about for many years in my documentaries, in my interviews you can find on the internet, but especially in my books. Because in my books, I wanted to bring you the evidence, and I wanted to bring it in a way that was also quite academic. So the critics will not, they will not know where to start to criticize. Because the thing is, when you give credible sources, you have credible citations, and documents, photos, and evidence, then it becomes it becomes a lot more difficult for those who criticize us and think we are all a bunch of crackpots. That's basically it. So my intention today is to make you understand where I come from and the reality of where I come from is what we hope we can avoid here in the United States of America, which is still a free country and a country that has not yet the oppression system which unfortunately we have in place like in Europe. In Europe and in Italy in particular, where I come from, is a place where now you can't even post on Facebook that you will get the police to knock at your door. And this is a reality. I mean, my wife who is with me was subject together with me for many years in Italy to persecution. Persecution in a Nazi style. Because when you have the police breaking your door because of a Facebook post or coming to just tell you, oh, the court has noted this post and has communicated for the judge, and you are like, that was just a post on Facebook and I shouldn't be liable for that. Yeah. No, unfortunately, when you go into an Orwellian scenario, Orwellian, now, maybe some of you know what means Orwellian, some of you don't. Do you know the book 1984 by George Orwell? Who knows?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, this book came together because at that time, George Orwell, H.G. Wells, and other people had foresaw the future because they had knowledge of what the elite was planning. And that's why it's not really a prophecy, but it's actually more like, we know how it's going to end up, so we're going to warn you. But the problem is that they can warn us as much as they want, but unfortunately, the heart of the problem worldwide resides not too far from here, in Silicon Valley. So we are in a moment in history in which we are about to witness some great changes for humanity. Changes which will be irrevocable. That means that in 20 years from now, the majority of the population could be not, actually, will be not thinking with their head anymore. will delete even the basic thoughts of what should I do when I wake up? Should I drink a glass of water, milk? No, the artificial intelligence will think for you. And it's already happening because already you get Alexa, all these things that they are created by Amazon, Google, and all the other players that are, of course, ways not only of spying and tracking every move, that is already old news. Now it's about imposing on us certain things. Now, in my books, I have used a system which is a very ancient system, which was in use before the invention of logic. It's analog, and it's in use in those fraternities like Freemasonry, where the allegories, the symbols, bring the candidate, the person, to think about certain things. That means the analogy. So these are, for example, the tracing boards of the first 3 degrees of Freemasonry with certain symbols. When I say analogy, it means that for each symbol, like the stairs of Job, of course I'm mentioning the Bible, or other symbols I find here, this is supposed to be, of course, the symbol of death here. We have in Freemasonry, but also in other systems of thought here in the West, a way of teaching people that there is other modalities, and Freemasonry actually works in the analog modality. So why is it important for me to tell you this? Because in my books, I've brought you not only the knowledge, but I put together with this knowledge certain pictures, certain photos, certain images, certain documents that then you can relate to those writings, which of course, and by assimilating and connecting maybe this image with this idea, it stays in your brain. In Silicon Valley, they understood that. That's why when you go in front of a computer, you have symbols. You don't have written, this is your browser. No, it doesn't work that way. There is actually a symbol, and that is the symbol that you relate to whatever browser you use. Of course, most of us use Nazi Google, but it is also others. And that means, of course, that we relate to symbols. Symbols are very powerful, and symbols are used since ancient times to transmit certain teachings and certain truths. This is an owl of the Illuminati. This is an official paper from the original Illuminati of Adam Reichel, this order that was founded in 1776. Now, in 1776, of course, we found also the foundation of the United States of America. But I would like to go back to the key player here, and when I found it, apart from him, of course, we know this Mason here with this apron, this guy was laying the cornerstone for Washington, it's George Washington, of course. But there is also another figure which I want to talk to you about today. And that figure is, of course, Benjamin Franklin. Now, Benjamin Franklin was the worshipful master of a lodge between 1779 and... Yeah, that should be 1781, not 1781, but sorry, I got wrong with that. In any case, he was a worshipful master of a lodge in Paris called the Lodge de Nonceaux of the Nine Sisters. In this lodge, they created and crafted the United States of America. The way we know it, because of course certain troops were transmitted. Then in 1783, then Franklin of course leaves Europe, leaves Paris, goes back to the United States. In this lodge there were people like, for example, Voltaire, who was a very important thinker. There were also good people in the Illuminati. It wasn't only a bad fraternity. The evil elements will take over the show because, of course, the founder himself was somebody connected to an order which we find inside the Catholic Church. And I don't me to be critic of Catholics, because I myself am still a Catholic, even if I consider myself a Catholic traditionalist and a set vacantist, which means somebody who doesn't believe in any hope after 1959, for a specific reason, because from there on, a certain branch of Freemasonry, which is not the same branches of Freemasonry which you find here. Here, the practice in the Grand Lodge of California, in all the lodges of the various states, a form of Freemasonry which is very social, very connected to, of course, what we have said regarding the allegories, the symbolism, and actually helps a lot of people. But in France, from 1875, they created a different form of Freemasonry. The Grand Lodge of France announced they abandoned the belief in the Supreme Being, which means abandoning the belief in God. At that point, it became the structure from which the most evil ideology in the planet, which is communism, which up until not so long ago, the US used to fight communism. Now, everybody seems to have forgotten that. It's very convenient to forget how things were back in the Cold War. But remember that before Islam, our main enemy was communism. And of course, communism now is allied with Islam. It sounds a very improbable alliance, but it exists. So, what happens here? Communism, this evil ideology that basically brings in the lodges of Freemasonry a different situation, because the lodges of Freemasonry, up until only a few years before, 1813, were open only to Christians. The foundation of Freemasonry was regarded to be Jesus Christ himself as a cornerstone, because each Mason who builds the churches and the cathedrals had to, of course, believe in Jesus, because you're building a church. Okay? So, the problem started when they let the atheists in, and also when they let the occultists, the people that started to follow this strange brand of syncretism, a little called New Age. New Age. Now, New Age is something that seems quite innocent, but is actually another entrance to a place which we don't want to go, which is, you know, we start connecting with the evil forces, the demonic legion, and it is something that we all should avoid. So, here in California, New Age is the place where they experimented New Age, and then unleashed it on the world. So California, out of all places, aside from Rome, is a place which is very responsible for what is happening in the world. So we can say that the responsibility starts though with Rome, with the Jesuits, and the Jesuits of course helped with the Franciscans, the establishment of the state of California. And they never really left the state of California and the grip they have in the state of California. They might have for a certain period of time let the more conservative forces around the show, but in the end they took it back. So the problem here is, what is happening in the world today? Is it like we are living some kind of end-time scenario? From my research, from my work, many years of experience, and the possibility also to exceed the secret archives and libraries, I can confirm that we are definitely living the end times scenario that is being prophesied for the Christians by Saint John. So it's a very important moment in history that I'm here to tell you these things, because most people don't want to hear these things, okay? Now, when it comes to the fact that today I have the honor to be in a VA post, and so I am very respectful of the military. I was myself once a military in the Italian Air Force, so I know exactly what it means to obey. You have to also understand that in secret societies, there is a military organization, and so I'm very used to it, because having been a Freemason for many, many years, and having also been in many other organizations, neo-templars, knights, and so on, the knights are all military organizations. So you behave in a military fashion inside these situations. Maybe I will be a general, the other guy will be outside, in the outside world, he will not be considered as such. But basically, Freemasonry itself, while here in America is still a social endeavor, in Europe and in places like Italy, where we had the P2 scandal, people ended up under the bridge, in Blackfriars Bridge in London at the beginning of the 80s. It's a serious thing. People got killed because there is connections with the Vatican Bank, money, power, military. It's a very different situation here, where the Freemasons are hanging out with the Shriners, doing things that are very innocent, sincerely. But the problem has also been that the upper echelons of Freemasonry, even here in the US, know exactly what is happening and have done nothing to stop this situation, which is, of course, a situation in which certain Masonic groups, also here in the US, like I talk in volume 3 of my confessions, are letting their lodges being used by Islamic organizations to promote the idea that there is a Mahdi, a sort of helper of the Messiah that is coming from the Muslim faith, and they actually indicated it, they indicated even the person. And this has been done in the Grand Lodge of Colorado, in Denver, not in some other place. So I have not yet been invited in a lodge in California, so I don't know yet what to expect, what I will see. I hope that I will see something positive, I really hope, because there is a lot of patriots that belongs to Freemasonry, and Freemasonry is a very honorable thing. And like I am a 33 degree, John Wayne was a 33 degree. So, I mean, it's something that is not necessarily evil, but we have to understand that there is elements who have created out of Freemasonry and out of these secretive groups, even more secretive groups that instead are emerged in Satanism. And groups like the Ordo Templi Orientis, the Temple of Set, there is many other groups that flourish here in the US that are basically satanic groups that have infiltrated Freemasonry. Recently I was speaking with a friend of mine who invited me to have a speech in a lodge in Albuquerque, in Mexico, and he told me that basically he went to a lodge once in Albuquerque and he started noticing that some of the members of this lodge had a demonic seal tattooed on them. And of course, as a Christian, if you see something like this, you freak out. And I spoke recently, I'm not going to say to who, but somebody here who was a Freemason amongst you, in the Grand Lodge of California, who had a similar experience, that there was something that it was a little bit too occult. So, from the Enlightenment era, the fact that they had to limit the invasive force of religion, especially the Church of Rome, because otherwise, if the Church of Rome had it his way, you would not have 1776. You would not have it, they want to control everything. So they have to distance, separate state and church. They have to do it. And at times, this unfortunately gave the opportunity to certain satanic forces to say, oh yeah, the church is bad, everything Christian is bad. No, that is wrong. Because the problem is, like the church, every denomination, I'm not saying one specific denomination, every denomination. And I'm half English, so my great-great-grandpa was also a Methodist pastor, so I am not only Catholic in my family, so I have various. But, I mean, the thing is that the church is made of men, just like politics, just like the military, just like any other institution. And men get corrupted. And lately, it seems that the corruption is pervading the whole of society. And we are living in a sort of libtard nightmare. So, I come from Italy, a place where basically a Freemason col occhio nero, with her sister, was in charge of spying on all the most powerful people in Europe. And when they actually went to arrest them in 2016, they took those servers to then plant the evidence that would then be used to accuse Donald J. Trump in turn. For that reason, in the month of May, at least 5 or 6 people were sent away from the Italian intelligence service, and a big scandal erupted just when I left Italy. Italy is important, guys. You know where is Obama today? You know where is Obama today?
In Miami.
Obama today is in George Clooney's villa in Lake Como, conspiring against the United States of America. And I know that, but that's what's happening. And we have Matteo Salvini, deputy prime minister, who came to Washington a few days ago to actually speak personally with Pompeo about this issue, because in May, those people were sent away. But those people who were planning, and they have planned since 2016, since the election of Trump, to dethrone him with this whole Russian spygate hoax, they are the same people who persecuted me, including Matteo Renzi, who is hanging out with Obama today, and George Clooney. Those people have persecuted me, my family, my wife. So these are my enemies, as well as Donald J. Trump's enemies. So I come here in the United States and I say, guys, we have the same enemy. So I can't live in Italy anymore because I'm not Donald J. Trump. I'm a New Zealand. A guy who has been brought basically to, has been spending all his money on lawyers in the last 15 years since I started this exposure work.
Chairman, the former president is plotting against the United States.
Sorry?
Who's seriously? The former president is plotting against the United States.
He's plotting against the United States, and we have the evidence. So it's not something built on theory. The fact that Obama had to meet these people in Italy is because they have to get their version straight. Because now Matteo Renzi is being cornered after I left. He's being cornered by some of my friends who are the friends who are in the league, in the party, the league. I have at least 2 people that were working with me in Italians for Trump. I was the president of Italians for Trump, the only organization outside of the United States that supported Trump before he was elected, and that celebrated officially. You can see it in the newspaper. You just go on Google and put Italians for Trump, 24 January 2017, and you will see that Leo Zagami and other people, including Antonio Maria Rinaldi, who's been elected now at the end of May in the European Parliament, the third person more voted, the second after Matteo Salvini, and another was my lawyer, Francesco Donato. So my people have gone into the European Parliament now, but it's not enough to save Leo Zagami, it's not enough to save Italy, it's not enough even to save America if you don't wake up. So we have to start the resistance here from the United States to stop becoming a socialist nightmare like what's happening in Europe. Because if we don't stop it now, this nightmare is gonna inexorably advance. And when I see the possibility here, like I was saying a little earlier to some people here, the fact that in California you can discriminate politically somebody without having any legal consequences. I have the immigration lawyer saying, set my face, I'm not gonna take your case because I'm active in the Democratic Party, you are the president of the United States. Okay. Wow, thank you for the honesty. If you were in Italy, you would be arrested for saying something like that, because you can't side politically with a faction as a lawyer. But this is possible in California. So, I know, I mean, it's a mystery, but... So, I come from a political background and a Masonic background. My grandfather was a senator, Italian senator. I come also, though, from a Masonic background, because he was also Freemason, because Freemasonry and politics have, since the time of Benjamin Franklin, been always connected. Now, how are we going to find a solution for all this? I need to explain to you through my books what has happened And then maybe you can understand that we are in a big mess here. So either we act fast, or either we have lost the game. Because the way I see the Democrats acting here in California is not the way of politics. No, no. It's the way of a sect, of a cult. They're not the... You know, when you debate democratically with another person, you create a debate. And up until Trump was elected, there was always, if you noticed, a debate going on. But after the elections of the president, then everybody forgot about politics for a while because everything went fine. You know, the dialogue, the attacks between the two parts will not happen anymore in the interest of national interest before everything else. And the military know that very well, because the national interest has to be always before everything else. But the problem is that the Democrats who are winning today in Italy are not for the interest of America. They have a transnational idea of separating the world in three continents with three respecting leaders. And that's it. And that is the new world order. And we have gradually arrived to the new world order because, of course, there has been a series of events. Now, a very important event, of course, was the Second World War, the end of the Second World War. It starts the Cold War. That was my grandfather, that was me when I was a little child, and that was his initiation in Freemasonry in Sicily in 1946 by these two gentlemen. Now, this gentleman here, called Prince Aliada di Monreale, is a guy you will see as a fictional character appearing for a fragment during the film The Godfather Part 3. The Godfather Part 3 has a lot of truths in it.
Yep.
A lot of very uncomfortable truths, even for the church. I bestow you the order of sons above, and the Godfather, yes,
yeah.
I need it, the immobiliare, I need it with the Vatican, now I can make the cash. Now, I know people see the Vatican beautiful, they think it's a great thing. The Vatican, unfortunately, is a place of great power, not only of faith. Of course, there is also faith, but in the last few years, especially since the end of the Second World War, the Vatican has been purged out of the Catholic, of the Christian elements during the Second Vatican Council, because there's been a group of people from France, from the Grand Orient of France, that infiltrated this Second Vatican Council, to then transform the church, and then at the end elect a Jesuit Pope, Pope Francis, because the Jesuits have never had their own Pope. Now, the Jesuits are not Christians. They are communists. They experimented communism in South America 3 centuries ago, and then they went on with their experiments, but they've been manipulating behind the scenes all religions in the last 5 centuries. The Jesuits have created a way of infiltrating the enemy because they don't show themselves as priests. Most of the time, Jesuits don't even dress up as priests. That's a crazy thing, people don't know. But for example, you can find Jesuits in the ghetto dressed up like a guy from a gang. You can find a Jesuit in another situation dressed up as a Muslim because he's pretending to be a Muslim. The Jesuits pretend many things. One thing that I have done, though, in the last few years is also this alliance with Islam, because the Pope is kind of merging these two things to create a sort of Chrislam. Now, all the Christian churches, all the denominations, have come together in the last few decades with this World Organization of Churches, which is puts together every denomination, so they have put together all the Christian denominations, now they want to get in the fold also Islam. Of course, certain Jewish elements of the Jewish community have agreed to join this thing because they participated in the Second Vatican Council. So we have a gradual formation of what is going to become a one world religion. And in 2020, next year, they're going to discuss the future. And the future is not about Jesus or the Holy Mary. The future next year discussing the Vatican is artificial intelligence and a religion based on the worship of the AI God. And that's passing through Silicon Valley. So the interesting thing about California is that a lot of elements, especially satanic elements, have sprung out of here, out of the back door. In 1966, Anton LaVey created the Church of Satan in San Francisco. Later on, one of his followers in 1974-75 shaped the new Temple of Set. It was Michael Aquino, who used to work for the military intelligence. And now, in 2013, we saw the birth of the Satanic Temple that recently has inaugurated and put a statue on the hill there. In Detroit, they have done this big inauguration with this Baphomet, then they wanted to put the thing on Capitol. They are preaching Satanism in the name of religious liberty. And it's like, we all have to accept Satanism. Personally, I don't want to accept Satanism, and I find it disgusting that they want to push even Satanism for little children with their booklets made where like comic strips. So I find that this moment in history is very important because we can make a difference if we realize that there is been a conspiracy built behind our back to strip us of our Christian identity. Because for them, it's not in God we trust. That's the thing, it's not in God we trust. They would like to strip even that from the field. You know, they have even discussed it. So the thing is that when you know that Joe Biden, 1 year ago, where did Joe Biden organize his meeting? And I talked about it in my book, Volume 6.66. He organized his crew meeting to prepare his presidency in the Vatican. And there was Deepak Chopra, Katy Perry, a big line of VIPs, all there, in the Vatican. Big room. Of course, the Pope paid for everything. Why the Pope should pay for Joe Biden? He's like, why? Creepy Joe Biden. So we have Joe Biden, who's been blessed by the Pope. And then there was Bernie Sanders, who was trying to have an audience with the Pope. And he was like, I remember he arrived in Rome, you know? And I, of course, I'm a Vatican, I follow the Vatican very close up, so I know all the moves in the Vatican. And say, oh, there's Bernie who is trying to meet the Pope for breakfast. He's trying to, he's there, waiting for the Pope to come out of the Mass, his morning Mass, so he can meet him. I mean, Bernie Sanders is everything to get a blessing from the Pope, and in the end, the Pope met him. Bernie, great, you're a nice communist like me. But that's it, great. But you're not as good as Joe Biden. So that's it. And all these Democrats go to the Vatican to ask the blessings of the Pope. Well, I don't know, guys, it's unheard of. Has anybody heard what's happening in Venezuela the last few weeks? Because it's gone completely out of the map with the media. Why? Because Maduro is a friend of Francis. So you can't kick out Maduro. You can try, but you can't, because he's protected by the Pope and by Russia. That's it. I mentioned the two things here. These guys, a connection between Moscow and the Vatican. And this connection goes through the most unlikely figures, which are in the Illuminati, and I actually put a photo in volume 6.66, which shows the Vatican Secretary of State together with Pier Giorgio Bassi, who met with John Podesta in March 2016 in a restaurant in Parioli, a fish restaurant, very nice. And with John Podesta, they were conspiring because at that time, I was the only, I represent the good side of the Illuminati. I have a small group of like-minded individuals who know these crooks in the Academy of the Illuminati. And so, you know, they know that we dislike them, and they knew that we, of course, have founded this time for Trump. Pier Giorgio Bassi went to counter Fede Esposito, who is a representative of Italians for Trump, in June 2016 and said, you don't stand a chance, we support Hillary. That's... when they lost! Wow! Guys, you should have seen their faces. They had invited me in a communist radio at 9 o'clock in the morning, and they had done it on purpose because they wanted to take it. They basically wanted to ridicule me by inviting the president of the United States at 9 o'clock in the morning to talk about Hitler or Hillary. Guys, I arrived there, and it was great. It was just like, it was the moment in which actually Trump was going to receive his speech, because the time difference made it possible. That it was exactly that moment, and you should have seen their faces. And I was there live on the radio, and they couldn't say anything. And I was like, whoa, great, we won, communists, how is it? I said, you see these guys, Matteo Renzi, the guy who was together with Obama, all these people, in 1 year from now, they will be all kicked out. And they were all kicked out. But those people, including the prime minister that followed Matteo Renzi, Gentiloni, conspired with Italian intelligence against the president of the United States of America. So we would like to know, as Americans, as now self, I rebrand myself as American, because nowadays I'm trying to be American, I hope I will become American. And of course, now that Trump knows about this whole thing, it's a big scandal. I mean, Obama should be arrested basically when he steps out of the plane back from Europe. He has already gone and plotted with Macron. He went to France to a meeting with him before going to meet Matteo Renzi. He plotted basically with half of Europe to dethrone. He plotted against the Italian government, he plotted against the French, Marine Le Pen, he plotted against Nigel Farage. They're trying to plot against those populist forces which are trying to save Europe. I personally had to give up on the fight because I don't have any more money, and basically I can't keep on paying my lawyers for all these court cases that they want to ruin me, they want to arrest me, they want to take my freedom. In Italy, on differences with America, that while in America you can settle a defamation case for something written in a book with money, in Italy defamation is a criminal offense. So you get, if you insult the president, the Pope, you can get arrested. So I actually got arrested at one point. And it took me 2 weeks and 3 lawyers to get out of it. And it was a nightmare. I mean, my wife, my beautiful wife, as you can see, she suffered very much, especially when we tried to win the Pitchforks Revolution between 2013 and 2014. My idea, once I saw that the Clinton Foundation was backing this criminal Matteo Renzi, best friend of Obama, and all these people, I created a situation in Italy whereby a bit like the Yellow Vest, they took the inspiration from the Pitchfork Social Arrest. You can go and check on Wikipedia, it's written Pitchfork Social Arrest Italy 2013. I was one of the creators of this social arrest. And my idea was simply to rebrand all these political movements of the right, of the center-right, into non-political movements, just with the Italian flag, march on Rome. If we gathered 25,000 elements, we could have actually got the parliament, because I had already made a deal behind closed doors with the police and other forces in Italy. Unfortunately, we didn't have more than 5, so we couldn't do the coup. But, guys, it was to stop these criminals from taking my own country. So, the moment in which they discovered that I was the one behind it, that's it. They literally broke the door of the house. I said, sorry, can I put my pyjama on? Oh, no! And the door was smashed. I'm not a terrorist. I didn't have weapons. The hidden weapons are very difficult to obtain. And these people had weapons, everything, and they break through the door. And imagine this. I had been till 2 o'clock at night, protected by the police, but then the Carabinieri, which is the military arm of the police in Italy, they came to stop because they said, you have insulted the president of Italy. I didn't insult the president of Italy. I simply stated on a TV show, on national TV, that this guy, who is an ex-member of the Partito Comunista Italiano, Italian Communist Party, financed by the Soviet Union, is a traitor. And he should, step down, which eventually he did, but he just simply put a puppet in his place. So, today, these people are conspiring in Italy because they are creating a sort of new renaissance in Florence. Tim McCook, the guy who owns up, all these people, they have bought this mega villa, multi-billion villa, they are planning these lavish meetings, but also, in the end, they are planning the takeover of this planet in a non-democratic way. Because that's what they're doing. They are forcing us in social networks, in the media, to only have their own ideas. If you have conservative values, you are censored these days on Facebook. We have seen it over and over again. It started with my friend Alex Jones last year, and it's simply continuing. And it's like, every time they block you, they censor you, they purge hundreds of my videos, because of course I collaborate with InfoWars, so all my videos have to be taken off. For some reason, my channel on YouTube survived only because it was registered in Italy, and they seem to have controllers for each country, so the Italian ones are not very good with English. and that also was what was happening with my Facebook when I was in Italy. I stopped talking Italian on the 1st of January to not be subject to any more persecution. You know what happened the moment I stepped into the United States of America? They blocked all my accounts.
Wow.
Everything. Everything there. Two checks, three checks. Oh, you have posted an article of Cardinal Berg condemning the Muslim immigration. You are banned for 30 days. Jeez. I didn't insult anybody. I actually posted an article, so not my words, about the words of a cardinal. Now, this cardinal is the only ally we have in the Vatican. A good guy, Raymond Burr. This cardinal is the friend of Donald J. Trump, who is trying to preserve those traditional values. And unfortunately, he was punished by the Pope immediately. When he started to oppose him, they put together a group of cardinals. He put together a group called themselves the Dubia Cardinals. They issued this manifesto. They sent it to the Pope, saying, "You are destroying the faith. You are doing things that are contrary to the faith. You are an heretic, basically. You should step down. You should resign." The Pope didn't resign. And Berg had control of the Knights of Malta, and he actually himself was sent away from the Knights of Malta because the Knights of Malta were deemed as a threat. When they saw that there were people in the Knights of Malta, like Conte Alfredo Esposito, that was in Italians for Trump, or others that were pushing the traditionalist movement, because there is traditionalist Catholics that are good people that don't want Pope Francis anymore as a Pope. Because this guy, he's not Christian. He doesn't believe in hell. He doesn't believe in anything. This guy doesn't believe. That's the thing. He doesn't believe. So, this is the first Pope. And one morning, I woke up in Rome, and there was Rome full of posters. With the posters of the Pope saying, you should resign. It never happened in recent history that a Pope was invited to resign. But it happens now. So, I am a person, of course, in my life, I had the luck of being related to these royal folks from Great Britain. The fact that I am related to them, this is the cousin of my grandfather, Elizabeth Borzlian, who was in turn the wife of King George VI, who is the father of course, Queen Elizabeth. So the fact that I had these relatives gave me the possibility to have an insight, and also gave me the possibility a lot of times to tell the truth, because a lot of times I could have got easily killed. But they are, you know, they try not to kill their own, if possible. Of course, they punish me in every way possible, because the moment I go against the family system, guys, has been a nightmare. And my wife has been witness to it. These people, they don't care if you are their son, you are their brother, you see it. They don't care. When it's if their interest of money and power, they lock you up. They are actually people. I mean, I'm sorry, it's my family, but guys, they are really evil. Oh no, man, it's just they can't help it. I mean, these are people who for thousands of years have had power. Real power over the life and death of millions, no? So, and now they have a guy like me who tells them to screw. Without saying bad words, but basically. And so, it creates a problem for them. There was, though, a person in my family, this guy. Now, Giuseppe Balsamo, Conte Cagliostro, this is the his marble. Statue, how we call it, that is preserved at the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. Okay? Now, Count Cagliostro, a member of my family called Giuseppe Balsamo, was also a Grand Master of the Illuminati, and he was the last victim of the Inquisition. I mean, to be the last victim of the Inquisition, I mean, you must be a pretty badass guy. Because, I mean,
my ears.
Count Cagliostro was initiated in the island of Malta by the Grand Master of the Knights of Malta. He went to Naples. He was initiated even deeper in the mystery of the Illuminati that come from ancient Egypt and before that from Atlantis. And went to London, went all over Europe. But at one point the Illuminati said, you have to work with us. We have the money and you have to prepare the revolution in France. Inspire the lodge of the Nine Sisters, because there's a gentleman that you need to meet. Benjamin Franklin, very big fan of Cagliostro. Because Cagliostro didn't give a damn about all these royal families. He was a member of my Sicilian family, and he was a guy that scared a lot of people, including the Pope. Imagine this, during his trial in the Vatican, the Pope used to watch from behind like a little thing. He was scared. He said, Cagliostro, I'm scared. So when they eventually sentenced him, he died in a terrible way, because they arrested him and they locked him up in a castle which bears my name, the castle of San Leo, which is in the north of Italy. They didn't give him a room where to stay, a normal place. They put him inside a place down, like, it was a pozzo, like when you have a wheel of water, you know, you put the people.
A well.
Yeah, like a well. So they would put his food down from on top every time, and he was left there for the rest of his life, which was only a few years until, of course, in those conditions, he died. A guy he had initiated a few years back in France came to save him, but it was too late. That guy was called Napoleon Bonaparte, another badass guy who also didn't give a damn about the royal families, and for that reason he would be killed after being arrested 2 times. Napoleon was a very nice guy. I personally like him, though he was very short, so we have, of course, the Napoleonic syndrome. But Napoleon, who was Italian, wasn't French, right? Because Corsica was Italian, then they made it French. So Napoleon was a little bit like Mussolini. This guy, the first time they arrested him, he just freed himself, went back into France, just like this, gathered the people who were around, boom, and he took the empire. I mean, this guy went to the Pope and said, I put the crown myself. So Napoleon Bonaparte took the Illuminati and use them. But when, of course, he didn't respect the rules to the game, a specific rule that they had, they eliminated him, arrested him, and then, of course, poisoned him. Because Napoleon died of arsenic poison. He didn't die, just natural causes, like they say. So this guy initiated Napoleon, Benjamin Franklin, and of course, George Washington was also fat. And nobody talks about it. I mean, we are here in the United States of America. This guy, Count Cagliostro, might be regarded actually as one of the people who inspired the whole thing, completely silent, because he was the last victim of the Inquisition. Of course, arrested by the Vatican, the last victim of the Inquisition, nobody can talk about this guy. But this guy wanted to basically unveil the truth about the Illuminati by creating an order called the Egyptian Order of Freemasonry, and he said to the Pope, let's make it an official thing and make everybody know about it. Impossible. The Pope said, well, you're crazy. Arrest this guy. But also, he was a particular guy because he was in contact with invisible forces that are not of this world. Here is something you can see very well, because unfortunately the image that we have. But this is another image, even more ancient, of another guy who was in contact with the same forces, a guy called John Dee. I don't know if you ever heard of John Dee. He is the inventor of the famous 007, his name, not 007. This was his original sign, 007. Watch it. It looks, not bad. Ian Fleming based his whole thing on this guy here, John Dee, who was the secret agent, the guy who created basically from scratch certain elements in the intelligence that was just shaping up in the reign of Queen Elizabeth I. Now, the interesting thing of John Dee was that he talked with some alien extra-dimensional, he called them angels. God knows if they were angels or demons, because the thing is, how are you going to distinguish one from the other? A lot of New Agers tend to make often this mistake and end up in the hands of demons that say they're angels. But 007 used to take the information from the other, let's say from the extra-dimensional world, for the benefit of the Queen of England and her army. He actually managed magically to stop the Spanish army from invading England. I mean, this guy was pretty strong magically. He had the biggest library of the occult the world has ever seen. And like Cagliostro, who came after him, he was in contact with entities that are not of this world. So Cagliostro's thing, the difference was that when people like Franklin or anybody that will come in contact with Cagliostro knew that Cagliostro will go in contact with these entities using a specific method that I will not go into, but it involved the use of somebody who had a pure heart, and that means either a virgin or a little child, that were put in isolation, and then he will get them to communicate with the angels. And that freaked out the Pope, because he actually said in a very detailed manner what will happen to the Pope when he was in Rome. The Knights of Malta invited him up in their headquarters, and when he said what will happen, which will happen soon after, when Napoleon invaded Rome and the Vatican was ready for the first and only time, and he said that. And so the Pope really freaked out about the power that Cagliostro had of communication. But also, he communicated with Enoch and Elias, these two figures of the Ancient Testament. There is some communications that later on were given also to people who were not in initiating environments. In France, for example, the Holy Mary of the Salet is a bit like the Holy Mary of Fatima. Certain revelations have been communicated to mankind about what's going to happen. Now, if you are a believer, if you're not a believer, you might just disregard it. But, unfortunately, I can tell you that when it comes to the revelations of Fatima, especially the ones that were not revealed by the Church, the first secret that was never fully revealed, it's very correct. It's down to the detail. And some of the prophecies even forecasted the fact that for the first time we will have two popes. And we have two popes. We have Pope Ratzinger, who is still alive, and we have, of course, Pope Francis. And certain traditionalist forces are trying with Pope Ratzinger to inspire some kind of coup so they can overtake Pope Francis. But Pope Francis is too powerful. The Jesuits are just a military order, and it's very difficult to fight. So we, here in America, should first of all understand the danger that comes from the Jesuit order, also by the Vatican and Illuminati that work with them, but also another force, Russia. Let's talk about Russia. Russia was the place that protected the Jesuits when the Jesuits were persecuted by the Vatican. The Vatican in 1771 decided to kick out the Jesuits. The Jesuits are now in power of the Pope. They were kicked out by the Vatican because they conspired too much. So even the Vatican said, you have to leave, you have to close down your order. They didn't close it down, they simply went to Russia and were protected by the Empress in Russia. From that moment onwards, the Vatican, Jesuits, and Russia forged an alliance, which still is ongoing. So Vladimir Putin might seem a very nice man, and for many reasons he is, for his own people, for the Russians, he is a good person. But he's not a good person for America because he's making the interest of Russia. And the interests of Russia are aligned with the interests of the Vatican. In fact, on the 4th of July this year, the 4th of July, while we will be celebrating, me personally, I will be in Austin, Texas with my friend Alex Jones. Others will be celebrating in other ways, but while we will be celebrating the Day of Independence, the Pope will be driving and putting in the Vatican. So, it's very clear the message here. The two enemies, the Pope and Vladimir Putin, and then here we have the only president that at this moment in history and in this moment we see represents true freedom and liberty still as a value that still exists here in the United States, which is Donald J. Trump. So that's how it is. And for me personally, it's going to be very important this year to stand on this side of the Atlantic because I want to be on the right side of history. I don't want to be on the wrong side of history. And I want to make it clear that this is a confrontation that is still, you know, is still nowadays being fought in this, let's say, in a civil way, civil manner. But when they're gonna take all our freedoms, at one point we're gonna have to do it, you know, we're gonna have to rebel for this. And here in America we can rebel, because here in America we're still free to have weapons, we're still free to talk, we're still free to carry weapons. In Europe, you can't carry weapons, you can't even, you know, it's impossible. So now they have changed a few laws, but it's very difficult to obtain the permission to carry a weapon in Europe. And people who have been in Europe know this very well. So the European people, just like the Chinese were unarmed when Mao came to power, because that's how the dictatorships work. Communist China, the first thing they did, they took the weapons. In 2012, what happened in Venezuela? All the weapons were taken. So never let your guns go, because that's the first sign of an incoming dictatorship. Thank you so much for having me here today. It's a very heartfelt applause. Now, I wanted to give the opportunity today. I will, of course, go maybe back into a little bit more of the technical side of things. But first of all, I wanted to have a moment of dialogue with you, who are the people who maybe have read the books, who maybe have followed through the internet. And I'm sure that a lot of you have a lot of questions. And because I know that you have a lot of questions, I will go back into my presentation, but first of all, I want to give at least a few minutes for some questions from the audience. So, We have here a very little young gentleman, not little, young, who wants to do it.
All right.
Is the Illuminati a cult? A cult?
Okay. Okay. Now, the Illuminati is not a cult. The Illuminati is a secret society. Okay? Now, certain people treated as a cult. Okay? The Illuminati initially were, when Adam Weishaupt created this Illuminati, he created various levels. He wanted to get the more people possible. So what he did was to make the people on the lower levels feel like they were joining a Christian order that didn't have anything negative. So you can actually go and read the instructions of the Illuminati, because they've been published with the whole rituals of the Illuminati in a book called The Secret School of Wisdom, which has been published only 4 or 5 years ago by a friend of mine called Joseph Wages. And they translated on the original ritual. And you can actually find how the Illuminati were convincing the lower levels that they were genuine Christians, and that genuine Christians were communists. Oh my God, I know. That's incredible, guys. But that's the thing here. Because the head of the Illuminati called himself Spartacus, he wasn't really wanting to be the head of a cult. He wanted to be the head of something that controls from behind the scenes the world. So he wanted to control the cults. He didn't want a new cult. Okay? So Adam Weishaupt devised a system for the first time in history where he instructed all his members on how to infiltrate political parties, religions, and everything else in a methodical way. He created the system that nowadays is in use by the terrorists, the cells created by Adam Weishaupt. So the fact that Weishaupt was very methodical in doing this means that he didn't really want to be a cult, because a cult leader is a guy who wants to go in front of the people, amuse everybody, be a sort of, you know, like the usual false prophet. That's a cult leader who wants to convince you that he has all the answers. With Weishaupt, he wanted to be like the Jesuits, because the Jesuits were his teachers. He was a professor in the University of Jesuits. The Jesuits in 1771, like I said, were made illegal, so he had to find himself a new job. But actually, at the beginning, he took the place of the Jesuits in teaching theology at the main university. So I would not say that he created a cult, but I can say that these days, a lot of Illuminati perceive it as a cult, because in 1904, a member of the Illuminati called Aleister Crowley, he had a different idea. He wanted to restart a new cult. And the cult would be called Telema. And the motto would be, do what thou wilt, which means do what you want, basically. So Aleister Crowley went to Egypt, him and his wife. He interrupted this magical ritual he was doing to go to Egypt and continue with his wife the ritual inside the Great Pyramid. He went inside the Great Pyramid to spend a whole night there with his wife, and he started to recite these demonic grimoires. Okay, these demonic grimoires have already a negative effect if you recite them in your kitchen. If you recite them in the Great Pyramid of Egypt, wow! So the wife, after a couple of days, got possessed, and she started to talk like in tongues, talk with things she couldn't have known. So Crowley asked, who you are? Who are? I said, I am the messenger of basically of Lucy. Of also Wolfgang Krapp. He was very specific about all these things, because he was interviewing his wife, who was channeling. So he said, at noon, for 3 days, I will channel you the book of the new religion that I want to give to mankind. This religion became the number one religion in a place called California.
California?
And Crowley said, I like this name, Cali, Caliph. Oh, let's call it Caliph. Yeah, OTO Caliph. So the head of the organization will be called Caliph. Wow. Because of California, eh? Okay, Caliph. But he said, because Crowley Islam so much that he practiced secretly with the Muslims and stuff. So he wanted to create something that was also respected by the Muslims. By reality, when you read this book that was channeled, you want to hear what he said in this book? He said, I'm sorry for what I'm about to say, but this book, I mean, who has read the Book of the Law here? Somebody has read the Book of the Law, Aleister Crowley? Is there somebody who has read? It's a terrible book. It says things like, spit Jesus on the cross, tear Mary apart, even spit on one. Anything has to be scraped out of the map because he is arriving with his new revelation. The problem with Aleister Crowley was that he ended up on the cover of Sgt. Pepper and he became the guru of all the musicians of the 1960s. The Grand Lodge of the Oak Hill. Wow. And of course then the best friends of the Oak Hill became the Jesuits. The Jesuits understood 100 years ago one thing. Because you did a good question here, and actually it brings me back to the roots of this problem here. Let's go from the beginning, because I want to show you the face of somebody here. Because he didn't actually start, this is Aleister Crowley, this guy. Okay, this is, put it in the big screen altogether, but in any way, this is one of his followers, how they are dressed up. It's a little bit more darker than Freemasonry, so aside from the aprons, you have them all covered. However, there is a guy, Aleister Crowley was born in 1875, okay? In 1875, there will be a society that was shaped, that will change the whole of the world. And I could be talking to you for hours on how this is a theosophical society that is now ruling the United Nations, that was embraced by Gandhi. Gandhi, yes, Gandhi embraced, even Gandhi embraced. So then, Theosophical Society helped me revaluate Hinduism. Theosophical Society was founded by a Russian secret agent, of course, a Russian spy, whatever. She was called Madame Blavatsky. Now, Madame Blavatsky claimed she was in contact with some extra-dimensional secret cheats. Out of the Theosophical Society came all the Satanists of the last 130 years. Nowadays, for example, the biggest Satanist here in California, professor, because he actually teaches somewhere, I don't know where, Michael Aquino, ex-lieutenant colonel of the military intelligence, he's a member of the Theosophical Society. Aleister Crowley, he was a member and he was somebody who was involved and actually even made a drawing for one of the books of Madame Blavatsky, The Silence. And this drawing actually resembles an alien. I don't have it now with me, but it's basically the famous drawing of the land, after I can show you. Have you ever heard of this drawing, the drawing of the land? It resembles an alien gray kind of entity. However, this guy here, now I'm going to tell you, because this guy is connected, his first black mass of his style was not celebrated in London like a lot of people would expect. No, it was celebrated close to Hollywood Boulevard, in the heart of the whole property. Have you ever been to Hollywood Boulevard? Since the year 2001, there has been a particular new creation. Has anybody noticed a change? In November 2001, when everybody, of course, especially in a situation like this, was thinking about 9/11, the Illuminati instead were creating their own thing. And they created in the heart of Hollywood, where they give the Grammy Awards, they created a big new scenario, which comes from the film Temperance, I think it's called, The Gates of Babylon, with the symbol of the ancient gods, Enki and Er. You will say, but what does this have to do with this whole thing? No, it has to do a lot. Because this whole thing that now is, I think it's like, they have Sephora, it's like a commercial center, and they have, anybody been in Hollywood lately and seen it?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I think actually I have it here, you know? I think I put it somewhere in my...
It's not far from the Trump store.
So. Here it is. Here we are. Hollywood Boulevard. Porsche.
It's like one of the...
It's incredible. I mean, people just pass in front of it and they don't think of, about what they pass. But this is the Anunnaki. This is the ancient, it's the gods, the demons of ancient Sumeria.
What?
And they're actually... The crazy thing was that exactly 10 years before 2001, in 1991, a guy called Ken Anger made a film which ended depicting this, which comes from a film that was called Tempest. It was a film made by a guy who had his first film screened, it was the first film ever screened at the White House. It was a film on the KKK. And we all know that the KKK was created by the Democratic Party, not by the Republicans, just so you know, man. People tend to forget that. Oh, those swimming around, they're all KKK. Yeah, the Democrats.
Yeah.
Okay, so, here we are. I'm sorry if you can't see it very well, but I would like to James DeFranco, you know this actor? James DeFranco?
James Franco.
The stoner,
James
Franco?
Yeah.
He's awesome.
If you turn off the light, you can see also this guy here. And you can see this other guy here. And this guy here is the guy who made the film Lucifer Rising and Invocation of My Demon Brother, which wasn't a film. It was actually the invocation of Lucifer on Earth made at the ex-Russian embassy in San Francisco in 1968. This guy. And one of the people involved in this celebration, I'll show you who it was, because it's incredible. This is the actual, this is the 11-minute film, a short film, but it's a ritual made in San Francisco at the Russian embassy. The music by Mick Jagger. You know Mick Jagger, Rolling Stones?
Yeah. Yeah,
I'm not saying little people here, because it's not a little bit. Suicide. Mick, suicide. People. James Franco in 2012 did the ritual in Venice Beach to evoke the forces of Satan on Earth. But of course, it's connected also to Oz, the great and powerful Oz. In fact, he does the movie, no? But Oz is also connected to black magic. But anyway, if you could see this writing here, this guy is Anton LaVey. He was also present in the ritual, okay? This is Kenneth Anger. This is Kenneth Anger. And this guy here is Bobby Bessolet, one of the Charles Manson murderers, assassins, who went to kill LaBianca in the Tate LaBianca murders. This guy has been given the possibility, maybe, of parole by the governor of California. Guys, this guy was actually enacting Lucifer in this movie, yeah? He killed people. And now, the state of California, because here his music has been used for the documentary of Lady Gaga on Netflix. So when I show you these things, they might seem detached from reality, but in reality, they are your reality. That's the feeling, eh? So it's not conspiracy. It's conspiracy reality. So, in this ritual, Bessolet, LaVey, Anger. Anger, Bessolet was his lover. He is homosexual, he is his lover. But the crazy thing was that Bessolet, at one point, argued with, at least legend says argued, who knows. What happened was that he escaped with the first filming of the ritual to bury it in the Mojave Desert. On the way, this is the story, eh? On the way, his car breaks down, wow, and a bunch of ladies from the Charles Manson family comes and help him. Woo, come and join us. Wow, guys, isn't that a crazy coincidence on this world, eh? But anyway, that's how Bessolet got involved with the family. Huh? But so you want to know what's written here that is more the crazy thing is that at the end of this ritual here it's written something which you should read. You can find it on the internet, I will show it to the people interested. It says Zap. You are pregnant. It's witchcraft. Member of the Church of Satan in 1966 was also Roman Polanski. Arrested, no, because he was never arrested, but condemned for pedophilia. Roman Polanski is a guy who made the film Rosemary's Baby. And Rosemary's Baby is the film that portrays the year zero of Satan. But also, if you see the film, during the film they say, it's the first time the Pope arrives in New York. You remember this film?
Yeah.
It's the year zero. It's the year zero of Satan. 1966, January 1966, is the first month after the end of the Second Vatican Council, when they destroyed the Catholic faith and they prohibited from there on to celebrate the Mass in Latin. And from 1966, in California, the Satanists start to celebrate the Mass in Latin. Wow! What a coincidence! It's pretty incredible, this coincidence. This guy who breaks his car and gets saved by the Manson girls. The other guy, yeah, but one thing, Sharon Tate, she was pregnant. So this is one of the rare moments of the original film that was never found again, because once he buried it in the Mojave Desert, the original Invocation of the Demon Brother was never found. This is one of the few fragments with Anton LaVey, Bobby Beslay, and some two guys that are not in the other version. Now, this is Charles Manson, this is Beslay, and this is Lady Gaga, and this is Beslay who made the music. When I saw this documentary on Netflix, we could call it Libtard Netflix, or Democratic Netflix, we could call it Left-wing Netflix. It's definitely something out of a dystopian movie, because it's just like Netflix, we have the voice of Barack Obama. So, when I saw this documentary on Lady Gaga, and suddenly I was watching it, and I started seeing certain images, and I was like, this reminds me of something. Then at one point I recognized the music. I said, what is this music? And, wow, no. That is the music of another film of Kenneth Anger that comes after Invocation of My Demon Brother. It's called Lucifer Rising. And is the portrayal of the Antichrist and how he will rise from the secret societies. And actually, there is Marian Faithfull in the film. There is Jimmy Page from Led Zeppelin. And most of the movie was actually finished in the basement of Jimmy Page. So, for this, by the way, Bobby Beslay is up for parole, maybe, eh? This year, maybe he's gonna join you soon here in California. We can all have dinner together. In California, everything is possible, and even letting this guy out after he murdered the people is that crazy stuff, guys. By the way, here we have Sharon Tate, then we have Mia Farrow, of course, Rosemary's Baby. This is actually the poster, the original French poster, because Roman Polanski was born in Paris. Paris is the place, I would say the worldwide capital of Satanism. Because 5 centuries ago, the first Black Mass was done by an Italian queen that was, of course, married to the French, so it was Caterina de' Medici. She convinced a Catholic priest to celebrate the first Black Mass by sacrificing a child during a Mass that would be done, so they could save, she could save her kingdom. That's how Black Masses started. And soon after they multiplied. And if you go and search in the history books, 100 years later, thousands of bodies were found in Paris of children sacrificed. But the thing about the Black Mass is that people don't want to understand. You can only celebrate a real Black Mass with a Catholic priest or with a Christian. You can't celebrate a Black Mass with a Satanic priest. People think, you know, Anton LaVey. No, Anton LaVey was just propaganda. Apart from the fact that Anton LaVey died in San Francisco in a Catholic hospital. Just so you know. But Anton LaVey was the popularization of Satanism, the first step. The first step to create the, that thing that now we have the satanic temple of Julian Greaves, and we have merging with the Democratic Party, and we have Satanists that has to be accepted by everybody because they are in support of Planned Parenthood, of the whole thing of Planned Parenthood and everything. They are for abortion, they are for all the terrible things, because, you know, we have to be accepting the religious freedom. So, you know. So the Satanism of today is not the Satanism of 1966. Now we are the new stage of Satanism, which is the political acceptance of Satanism as a political reality. That's the last stage before the takeover. Eh? So they were planning the birth of the Antichrist a long time ago. And of course, Paris, France, is one of the places that is more important for them. That's why the new series of Rosemary's Baby that came out on TV 5 years ago, where was it based anymore? It wasn't based in New York anymore, it was based in Paris. Rosemary's Baby new TV series was based in Paris, because Paris is the center of all evil, guys. It's not a joke.
Not Germany?
Paris, because Paris goes back, I told you, it goes back 5 centuries because they had actually invented black. If you go in the history books, it tells you the invention of black mass was done by the Adrian Medici in Paris. So it's not like, so keep in mind that. And by the way, as I said, all this was connected with the other guys we saw before. Now, this guy here, a great guy, I don't know if you ever heard of him, Father Malachi Martin. Have you ever heard of him? Good. Father Malachi Martin, he was a Jesuit. He was a Jesuit, he didn't like the Jesuits anymore. He didn't like what he saw in the Second Vatican Council, where he participated as the secretary of the most powerful Jesuit cardinal, Cardinal Bear. And he left the Jesuit order and came to the United States to fight the devil as an exorcist, okay? Now, though he wasn't a Jesuit anymore, and technically he only kept certain vows, like the vows of celibacy, he actually continued in the ministry of exorcism. But at the same time, he was in contact with other Catholic priests and Jesuits, like Father Alfred Kunz and Father Fiore. I'm telling you this because these guys will end up dead, including Father Malachi Martin. And actually, you can, this is one of the rare things on Netflix, which is good. You can find the documentary on Father Malachi Martin, which actually finally reveals, with the testimony of a CIA agent, that he might have been killed. In 1999, Father Malachi Martin died. And after he died, the Catholic Church approved the last of the reforms, destroying the rite of exorcism, abolishing the traditional Roman rite in exorcism, substituting it with another version. In my book, volume 6.66, I include the original version, and I show you prayer after prayer, sign of the cross after sign of the cross, all that has been changed, so they can facilitate, and of course, they can facilitate the invasion of the demonic in our sphere by not having an effective exorcism. So this guy here was instead killed in 1998. He was killed. And you can go on the internet and put his name, put Google, murder Alfred Kunz, satanic. He was killed by Satanists. And they killed him, they made him drink his blood, they murdered him in the worst way possible. Alfred Kunz, this is a hero of the traditional Catholic Mass, who likes still the Latin Mass. He was killed, and there is a lot of suspicions that he was killed by other Catholic priests that were Satanists. He was the biggest Satanist, and not the ones in the satanic ritual abuse of the 80s. That was a way to make you, you know, at the end of the satanic ritual abuse scare, nobody is lying. Oh no, there is no Satanist, it was just, they got it wrong. But in reality, the real Satanists are the ones that now have been investigated by the Pennsylvania court all the Catholic priests that have been, there's been found evidence that they practice satanic rituals with children. And that is not something you're making up. So, Father Malachi Martin died in 1999. He died murdered in 1998, and they were collaborating to a project together with another guy, William H. Kennedy, who was the cousin of Kennedy. Nobody says this, a writer, he wrote a book called Lucifer's Lodge, and he also dies mysteriously in 2013. They all died. Fiore dies also in 2003. Everybody dies because they were revealing the secrets and the secret connections of the Catholic Church and the Jesuits with Satanism. They even, William H. Kennedy in his book even proves evidence of the connection between Michael Aquino and the Jesuits. So, serious stuff, very serious stuff with evidence. And here there is another thing which unfortunately you can't see, but I can tell you who is this guy. This guy is Pope Francis, and this guy is Cardinal Rampolla, and this is a document in the Illuminati from Aleister Crowley that shows that Pope Francis' apostolic lineage comes from a Satanist, Cardinal Rampolla, who in the same year as the famous 1904, he was not made Pope, because at that time, unfortunately, there was an emperor in the Austro-Hungarian Empire who said, no, I don't want a Freemason as Pope. And Cardinal Rampolla didn't become Pope. But the apostolic lineage of Rampolla was transmitted all the way to Pope Francis. And it's not a coincidence. Now, in the Vatican, there was this guy. I don't know if you ever heard of him, in the 90s. Monsignor Bilingo. He was the number one exorcist in the Vatican. Then, of course, the Pope didn't like him too much. And then he ended up marrying with the kind of South Korean in that Church of Moon, I don't know what that. But what happened was that he exposed the Satanists in the Vatican already in the at the end of the 90s, when he was still a cardinal. And he said, as an exorcist, there is Satanist in the Vatican. And he's not the only exorcist who said it. Father Gabriele Amos, the biggest Catholic exorcist, and there is also a documentary about it made by the filmmaker, the film director of The Exorcist. So Father Amor is the top exorcist. And he said there is Satanist in the Vatican. There is cardinal to celebrate black masses in the Vatican. So it's not me saying it. I also refer to credible sources. And here is the New Age, which is of course something. Now, Jay-Z. You see, this thing he has written here, Do What Thou Wilt, which is the motto of Aleister Crowley. Here is with Obama, of course, and then you have Beyoncé, Woman of the Year, Time, and then you have, of course, Jay-Z, Man of the Year, Time. They're all famous people when they hang out with Obama, and they, of course, they're all part of this conspiracy, which is to transform a society in a society with degenerate values that don't have anything to do with Christianity. So let's go to the next question. Please.
I have a question.
Okay.
So my question is, if we have satanic things going on, satanic mass going on within the Catholic Church, and all of these negative things and all these seances are being done, what can we as non-religious people do spiritually to protect ourselves from this, Luciferianism and this Satanism that's going on in the world? Like you said, you want to be on the right side of the world. How do we do that?
Well, I think that the only solution to fight ultimately the devil and his legion is always to preach a full alliance to Jesus. Jesus is the only way. So there is no other way. Of course, if you are maybe coming from a different tradition, I don't say that exorcism is an exclusivity of the Christian faith, because exorcism is something that pre-exists Christianity. But the modalities in exorcism with other religions is Islam, for example, has their own version of exorcism, and there is the Jewish faith has their own version. Each one has their own version. But the most effective one is the one made through the intercession of Jesus Christ. That is, I think, always like. Having said that, if there is people who don't believe, unfortunately, people who don't believe are people who often fight these things without knowing it. They get possessed without knowing it. They live a very sad life because they don't have any defense. While me and you can say, you know, we can, like, I personally, myself, I was exorcised and then I became an exorcist, see? And since I arrived here in the United States, I already practiced one exorcism, which seems to have gone very well. So I have my own weapon, which is a holy relic, which I have, which I have been given permission to carry by the head of the Cappuccino Order, which is the Order of Friars of St. Francis, which is a relic of the stigmata, of the bandage of the stigmata of Padre Pio. And I carry this relic because it empowers more when I do the exorcism. Exorcism is a very, very dangerous thing. I don't suggest anybody to even go near an exorcist because it's very dangerous. The thing is that people don't understand. It's like the movie The Exorcist. At one point you have to take the demon inside you. And then you have to expel it. Otherwise, if the exorcist, the guy ends up out of the window, down the stairs, in the famous scene, which was done, by the way, inspired by Pierre the Dad, who is like, this guy was the top exorcist, but also the guy who inspired transhumanism, who Wyatt called the father of the internet, and who inspired not only the film The Exorcist, Father Teilhard, I don't have a photo here, but maybe I have, I'm going to find it for you, is a guy, a Jesuit, is a guy who influenced, he influenced the making of the film 2001, Space Odyssey, and The Exorcist, two different films that have nothing to do with each other. But this guy was highly significant, even highly influential. And his writings have always created a lot of controversy, but they're enormously influential within the New Age sphere. Okay? Because the Jesuits ultimately are the ones who control secretly all the New Age. New Age was created by the Theosophical Society of Madame Blavatsky, promoted by the Freemasons who were in alliance with Madame Blavatsky. And then ultimately, it was, they had a meeting to create the basis for New Age movement in Mount Veritas, Switzerland in 1920. And after that, they all moved the project and the experiment in California. And in California, it manifested from the 60s onwards. But it was all done with the control of people like Huxley and people who knew how to. The Tavistock Institute, have you ever heard of the Tavistock Institute? Somebody heard of the Tavistock Institute?
What?
Tavistock Institute.
Yes.
It's an institute for geosocial engineering based in London. The techniques then were used in the programs for mind control, like MKUltra, no? But all this mind control, ultimately, was not just the experiments done and closed doors by giving LSD to military or whatever. But they were conducted on people like, okay, let's give 10,000 acids in Woodstock and see what happens. That's experimenting with livestock. And they're happy to experiment because they're like, yeah. So everybody in the end of the 60s, unfortunately, was manipulated. And where was the place where the whole flower power movement was born?
San Francisco, California.
So as you see, it all ends up here. And when the flower power movement ended up because of Charles Manson and his murders, that they went on the dark side, no? Suddenly the age of Aquarius turned very dark, you know? And that was the end of the age of Aquarius. Actually, the end of the age of Aquarius was planned by these occultists. People like LaVey and all those people have made a ritual before actually the whole thing unleashed. So, I mean, there is a lot of things that happened here in California that influenced the rest of the world. That's why California, you ask me, how can we help the rest of the world? And the rest of the world has to see that California has changed. So you have to change your neighbor, to change the people around you. Like a politician here who is presenting himself, he's doing a great thing. I hope that you will all vote for him. But I mean, it's like little things, you know, that help. And so I think in the end, people will say, wow, in California, finally they have changed. Now we have to change too. So I think that California has the responsibility to become really a place where you're giving a good example of how to go back to Paris. Don't you think so? Huh? You think it's a good idea? I think it's a good idea.
Yeah, I heard you say ancient Sumerian and like the demonic leaders, like Anunnaki, like what do you, what's your take on that? You said demonic leaders are like, I don't know, the demonic leaders, of course, ancient entities that maybe in ancient times were perceived as gods.
We perceived them as demons because we understood that we were serving them. In the old days, in the ancient days of Mesopotamia, in the days of ancient Egypt or ancient Rome, these gods had their own temples. We had to bring the sacrifices, everything, you know? Then, at one point, all this was abandoned because finally Christianity arrived. And we embraced a new value that rejected all those values. Unfortunately, though, Catholicism, on the contrary of more pure forms of Christianity, because of the fact that Christianity was born in Rome, and Rome had a lot of religions, had to embrace some of these other religions in order to go further with their own religion. And that was a little bit of a compromise that Christianity, early Christianity, especially that then became Catholicism. That's why Catholicism is the form of Christianity which is more similar to paganism than any other form. Real Christianity again, because we know that the Vatican is not telling us the whole truth. Does somebody of you believe that the Vatican is telling us the whole truth about Christ? There is some things that we don't know. So I hope I gave you a good answer. Thank you. Okay. What? Tell me, tell me.
I have a question. Satanism, does it only exist in this dimension? And if so, is there a higher dimension could defeat their
very good
power?
Question.
Such as the extraterrestrial from
Ohio. Okay. Now, Satanism exists in this dimension because we invite these demons to enter our lives. If I don't think about them, that's why doing the kind of work I do is very dangerous, and you have to really have 100 crosses around, and you have to really be like moving. And sometimes it can happen that you feel possessed by one of these things, so you get to get immediately exorcised because it's a risky business. But we are inviting them in our dimension, you see? Now, the problem is that we had like a wall around this planet that defended us from Gog and Magog, from the forces of evil. This wall was basically mined, and we opened the gates of hell around it. We opened the gates of hell gradually. When Aleister Crowley did the Coronzon ritual in Northern Africa, Aleister Crowley had his followers here in California, especially two followers, Jack Parsons and Ron L. Hubbard, who founded later Scientology. These people went in the Mojave Desert and they opened the gates of hell. And soon after, we started seeing the UFOs. So I think I gave you an answer. There is also angelic beings on the upper levels. They don't come and talk with normal beings, I guess. A lot of people fortunately elude themselves thinking they're talking with an angel, like I said earlier on. But to talk with an angel, either you have to be like him, but the innocence is essential. Please. Okay, where do we want to start?
There you go.
First question, go.
The societies are so secret, do they communicate in secret also?
What's
like
that?
Gematria and things like
that? Okay. You're talking about esoteric knowledge. Well, when it comes down to the secrets that are transmitted by the ancient mystery schools, of course they have been transmitted with initiations because only the wealthy of certain knowledge, but that becomes then a sort of Gnostic concept of Christianity that goes against what Jesus ultimately wanted for us, because Jesus wants that in the end the truth should be revealed for all of us, no? But the truth has to be revealed so we can be set free, okay? Now, this doesn't happen for the Gnostic. It doesn't happen for certain forms of early Christianity that said, no, the majority of people are not worthy for the teachings of Christ. Just, we can't hear, we have to make it all cryptic, we have to communicate it with initiation, we have to make, because at one point also there was a persecution that went on from the mainstream Christianity to other forms of Christianity. We retain some secret teachings that Jesus gave. But the problem is that in the end, real Christianity can never stand with what is secret and hidden, because in the end the truth needs to be revealed to everybody. Because that's the, if there is something that needs to be having a more communistic approach, is knowledge. And that is the only good thing that happened during the Soviet Union. I remember going to Russia the first time, and one guy told me, the only good thing of this communist experience, which was a nightmare, a complete nightmare, because you can't pay the doctor as much as the guy who is digging the cabin and say, no, but everybody ends up not working, everybody was lazy, you know, I mean, if the doctor gets the same money as the guy working at the Burger King, I mean, obviously everybody becomes lazy, okay? So, the communism is a failing utopia, but one good thing that the Russian people still, at least from the time of the Soviet Union, still have, is that everybody was educated, was given knowledge, access to knowledge. And one thing that I found very interesting when I went the first time to Russia was that I got given these school books in which I found teachings of the satanic influence of Aleister Crowley in rock music was teaching the schools in the Soviet Union. But it wasn't teaching in the schools in the United States. So something is very wrong here, because if communists are teaching something like that, it's strange, very strange, you know? Then the moment in which communism finally was sent, casted out of Russia, they re-embraced orthodoxy. The problem, of course, is that behind the scenes, then the people in charge stayed the same, because Vladimir Putin went from being a KGB agent to being the president. So, and he didn't, from actually, when first he became mayor of St. Petersburg, and then he became president. But the thing is that the only good thing that communism ever created, and it's only one thing, and I'm sorry, but it's not worth the hassle, is knowledge. We should all have access to knowledge. That is definitely something. Okay, hope I gave you a good answer. Okay, next one.
Yes, I was going to ask a question. So you mentioned, like, you know, when you do your research, you have all these crosses around you. I had mentioned my story about going to the Vatican and having friends in the monastery. So my question is this: when you look at, you know, there's that element of people that are into Satanism, and let's just leave it at that. How deep it goes, but they're into it. Then there's a group of people that are oblivious to it, that it even exists. My question is, when you look at evil, just evil that happens in the world, and how we transpire evil, whether someone harms someone for no reason, or someone destroys something for no reason, however you look at evil, how is that evil element, how is that evil element affected as far as when we're talking about Satanism? Like, when you talk about evil entering you, like, you know, you have to be prepared. Where does that evil come from? Was the person wake up one day and say, yeah, you know, I don't like the kids today, so I'm going to get rid of them? Okay. Where does that element come from?
Okay. That evil made sure that those seeds of evil were planted 100 years ago, they actually grow. 10 years after Crowley died in 1947, his last followers were in California, but other followers were at the Beat Hotel in Paris. One guy was called William Burroughs, the other one was called Brian Geisen. We're talking about the beatniks, the invention of the beat movement. This evil manifested gradually. In the 60s, this culture infiltrated and was deemed as cool. We went in search of the Eastern gurus. Everything that came from the East became trendy. And all these mantras, oh, wow. You know, everything that comes from the East is great. And all this was planned. So this evil gradually entered the society. The values of Hollywood changed gradually. So Hollywood was transmitting good values, family values, values, Christian values. You put on an old movie, maybe of course you can debate if the Indians were treated bad, the cowboy Indian were, but in the end you were transmitting positive values. There were Christian values in every movie. You were not transmitting communist values because we had a whole thing happening in America against communism in Hollywood. I mean, and I recently saw a film of 2005, a film director of course was George Clooney, who today is meeting with Obama. And this film from 2005 depicts the McCarthy and the witch hunt of communism, okay? And they're actually showing this witch hunt in a way that, you know, it seems like, wow, we persecuted the communists, so bad of us to have persecuted this communists, so bad. If we didn't do that back then, we would end up already like this 50 years ago. So we are given the possibility to this evil to enter both from the invisible world, but also from the physical world in our houses, because the biggest magic that today we have is Hollywood. And it's these movies and these things that are projected on us. So that's how evil enters our life. And it's entering every institution.
It's stimulated, you're saying.
Well, it's actually entering because some people get possessed by watching a movie. Some people get possessed by playing a video game. Now they have they have video games on the smartphone with Ouija board. You know that?
Ouija board
on the phone, and they have actually had cases of people possessed after they play the video games. There is one thing is that people understand. One of the biggest fans of video games was Anton LaVey. Now there is a film that came out in 1981, I want to show you. Maybe some of you can actually see this film, because this film is actually for free on YouTube. Not you, because you're too young for this film.
Evil Speak.
Anybody have seen this movie? Made by the way, it was filmed in California in an ex-Jesuit convent. Have you ever seen this film? From 1981. I'm sorry that I can't show you the last phrase that is actually given by this computer. We are talking about a film that in 1981 is depicting the use of the internet, which still wasn't even, it wasn't a CERN, 10 years later we make the internet available. So internet was, but there was a primitive form that connected the university.
Computers were out, they didn't remember just
the internet. Well, but this, for example, was an old Mac. And they show at the end of the film a phrase by the devil. And the film starts with this guy here in California, the tradition of an ancient satanic group of an ex, of course, Catholic priest and seminarist. It's a very interesting film because there is some elements of this film which you should, and actually the way it's done from 1981, it was really high tech, very high tech. Please.
I have a question about the holographic Lucifer that I've been hearing stories about that was supposed to come around in 2020, where they said there's going to be the internet, AI,
Cyber Satan. Yes.
Put out by, could you give a little bit of
yes. Like I was saying before, next year in the Vatican, all the people, the experts of the world are going to meet up to discuss the artificial intelligence, all the cardinals. And there is already a Jesuit that Pope Francis has nominated that deals with robotics and artificial intelligence. When the Pope went to Dubai, actually in Dubai, they experimented the first Robocop. Do you know that? There is actually, in the streets of Dubai while we talk, a Robocop that goes around and he basically, I don't know if he can get you arrested yet, but he can find you, he can monitor you, And it's not just like a bunch of cameras like in front of Walmart like you have in America. No, no, it's actually a robot that works and has artificial intelligence. Now, they're investing a lot of money because in 10 years from now, actually maybe 10, 15, there is going to be a robot that is going to be knocking at your door saying, sorry, you have not been microchipped yet, we are here. Now, how can we stop these robots? Because the thing is, okay, we can have the weapons, but against these robots, I don't know if they're going to work out. I mean, if you shoot an AK-47 on a robot which is fully bulletproof, the guy is going to inject you with a microchip. And if you don't take the microchip by injection, you're going to have to take it like a pill. And actually, the pills now are intelligent. So the people who violate the rules of the system, like this, like moi, can be locked up and given psychopharmaceutical drugs controlled by a microchip. So basically, if you don't take them, you have to take them. So this is what they want to do.
What's your take on some of the
technology? So cybersecurity is coming in artificial intelligence because, like Elon Musk said, that's it. Once you have built that, it's a 1,000 years dictator, a Satan dictator, and robots, impossible to refute.
Do you have any information or what's your thoughts on some of the technologies that we're seeing being implemented, like chemtrails, aka geoengineering?
People are worrying too much about geoengineering and chemtrails, which I think is a great problem, man. Don't get me wrong. But when we go around with a mobile phone, which basically already is experimenting with us, the AI systems, without our knowledge, and we are worrying about the chemtrails, I mean, guys, we are being around this gadget here. We should be worrying about that.
But they're saying that through the chemtrails, the nanotechnology is coming.
Yeah, because what they want to do is like, we have the 5G system, no?
Yeah.
And so 5G is going to be a bunch of satellite projects. So, okay, the chemtrails can facilitate the terraforming and all that. That, of course. But personally, myself, at the moment, I'm very worried about artificial intelligence and the fact that we are underestimating the use of artificial intelligence. And we are actually underestimating the fact that somebody like him, in 10 years' time, might have people of his age who don't think anymore. Because they delete the, you know, the thinking. I mean, why should they think? You know, we are embracing a technology that is about to make us stop how to think, the basic thing. If you went to school 50 years ago, we knew how to make 1 + 1 = 2. If you go to school now, I don't know about that. If you go to a school in 10 years, 15 years from now, they might not even know how to go to the bathroom on their own. Okay. It says that I have to drink water because I'm sick here, otherwise, It says I have to eat. Tell me, yes, it says I have to have sex. But it says only for procreation. And you think this is a joke? No, because now they invented the condoms with microchip inserted in there. So when you do, sorry for you, but you know, how can I say? Sometimes it happens. But anyways, the condom with the microchip. Why do they have to have a microchip in the condom? Why? Because they need to know every single detail of your bodily function, and you know. Soon they could be taxing you if you see too much. I don't know, it could be some strange stuff that they pull off these lip tats. I don't know, but they are putting microchips in the gum. Is that crazy?
No, I guess I'm blown away. I don't know daily work.
Just a two questions here, or two part.
I like your hat. I'm crazy.
The Illuminati,
yeah.
Deep State, Globalist, NWO, and the power place of Democrats. They're all the same people.
Yeah, and then, but there is a few neocons that matter the pose also, right? And that's a few neocons. We saw the Bushes were fully in bed. I mean,
But there are pushing up those the other, but that's not true.
And the other thing, I came across some pretty compelling evidence a couple months ago that showed the Muslims in the 1600s got in bed with the Illuminati. Do you want to think about that?
The actual Illuminati from Adam Beish, because we call the Illuminati the ones founded by Adam Beish. In reality, the real Illuminati were founded at the time of ancient Atlantis, were filtered down the various ancient mystery schools, and Adam Beish only created that political branch of the Illuminati. But he also was fascinated with Islam. The Illuminati started to be fascinated with the use of the Quran for manipulating somebody, okay? Now, I have experimented myself with this, because I'm somebody who has, everybody knows this, is it, in my books, I collaborated with intelligence services, various countries, I did things. Back in my days, some of things were good, some of things were less good. But anyway, I had to do a lot with Islam, and I understood, in my own personal experience, that with the Quran, I could brainwash anybody, and after half an hour from a mosque, that guy could be basically a potential terrorist. And it could happen so easily. Really? You just needed to know a few of the surahs of the Quran, which were these key surahs, which are passages of the Quran, in which they, of course, instigate hate, instigate against Christians, against Jews, and you are. You know what happened? During the MK Ultra era, they experimented with LSD for many years to try to manipulate people to do things. Then they discovered at the end of the 70s, actually in the middle of the 70s, but during the era of Carter especially, they went into the Quranic schools and they brought back all the forms of Islam that were nearly lost. And they brainwashed a whole new generation of Muslims. The Muslims, 50 years ago, if you went to the Middle East, they didn't wear all these rubbish veils and stuff. They were wearing that kind of clothes. You just go, I mean, it's very easy. Because you go to, if you go to Egypt, anybody that's been in Egypt today, you can see the old black and white movies, and you've been in Egypt, I know that you've been in Egypt, and many other people have been in Egypt, you know? And they show always these old films from the 50s in Egypt. Nobody wears them. They all dress European. They all wanted to be European. We were inspired there. Unfortunately, at one point, the Illuminati, the dark forces of the New World Order, Deep State, wanted them to go back to that form, which was originally inspired by a guy called the Man of the Mountain, Hassan Isaba. 1,000 years ago, in Islam, they created a group called the Ashashids. From Ashish, the smoking of the Ashish. So this is what they did with the terrorists in 9/11. Of course, we know that these terrorists were not only Muslims, they were also tools of something else. But the way they inspired them was exactly like the Ashashids. They showed them, the Ashashids had an initiation which was like this. I show you the initiation of the Ashashids. I bring you into a room, I show you a beautiful group of native ladies, I make you smoke a couple of joints, and I tell you, you like this? Well, this is heaven. You can have it if you die for us. This is, and that's why, if you go and check out, all the terrorists of 9/11 were watching porno movies and smoking hashish before 9/11. And it's not a coincidence. They bring what, and so, when I understood this, I wanted to experiment how it is to manipulate people. And I tell you guys, in the mosque, half an hour, and I could get people to just and blow up anything. And it wasn't like, it was an experiment, just to, of course I didn't get them to blow up anything, but I saw that with this book you have more power than any drug. I mean, I can give you 10 LSD, I didn't have the power of this book. Because the problem with our society here in the West is that nobody, especially in Europe, not in America, nobody believes in the Bible anymore. We have lost the Christian roots. So these Muslims arrived in a place where nobody believes anymore. And they have an easy fit, you know, they can convert easily because, of course, they arrive in a society which is not believing anymore in anything. Now, in the 70s, the Illuminati were promoting communes. So the big idea during the Cold War was to promote and make cool people like Che Guevara. Okay? So if you went into, I don't know, the suburbs of Naples or Rome or Milan, it was cool to follow Che Guevara or Mao Zedong. Okay? Nowadays, you go in the same suburbs, it's cool to follow the Islamic fundamentalists. They simply switch to another brand or terror. But the makers of this whole project are the same, unfortunately. Other questions?
Here. There's one question I was wanting to ask you, and we always hear about Western secret societies, but
yes.
We also hear about Eastern secret societies.
Eastern secret societies.
And it seems like it's just like what we see in the news, you know, the war between East and West, the war between Eastern secret society and Western secret society. Some say they have all the votes, some say we stole it all from them, Western secret society.
It's a very good question.
What?
It's a very good question you're doing, and I like it because actually I wrote about it in one of my books, according to, I don't know if I have it properly here, but it is true. There is in this new world order made of secret societies and Illuminati, there is still some conflict, but there is a group of 6 million Chinese who belong to a secret society which is very powerful, and actually it's a secret society that has a very, very powerful base in San Francisco, which is the oldest Chinese community in the US, and the most powerful lodges of this group are in Taiwan, Hong Kong, San Francisco, and they actually have even, the incredible thing is, you can go and check it out, the Communist Party is not the only party in China. There is also the Xian Party, which is the party of the Freemasons of China. But Freemasonry in China doesn't have anything to do with Freemasonry here in the West. Okay, the Chinese copy everything, okay? This is like, they like the mobile phone, they want to make the same. 3 centuries ago, when they saw that here in the West, we like the square, the compass, the aprons, all this Freemasonry, they had some very ancient secret societies that were fighting some internal battles. Oh, wow, we like this, let's get the compass and the square. So now, all those triad groups are controlled by Chinese Freemasonry, which has nothing to do with Europe and has no contacts even. I was one of the few people who ever entered contact with them. But they are, I mean, their initiation is very basic Chinese Freemasonry. You basically go downstairs, they make you go downstairs, a man with the incense, he shows you a bunch of skeletons and he says, you want to end up like them? No, okay, you will go back upstairs. That's it, that's initiation. It's like, you know, it's very basic. You know? So,
it's kind of confusing because they say they're called dragons. So you call
But the thing is, that's a joke. Yeah. I approved that the dragon family, in volume 2, the dragon family, very important what you said. The dragon family doesn't exist. The dragon family is simply the triads. The only family that exists eventually is the family of the founder of Communist China, which people don't know, is the same family of the founder of Taiwan. Because Taiwan and Communist China share the same founder, who was a Chinese Freemason of this group, and their families have a lot of money and bonds. Some of these bonds were given to Taiwan to fight Communist China, but were left around, and then ended up surfacing in Europe, as you know, in 2009 in Italy when they were confiscated, and I was called to talk. I don't know if you know that story. You find it more easy. But that was an interesting story, because these Chinese want to apply financial terrorism to show their power to the world. But all that thing about they fighting the Illuminati and stuff, what are they fighting? The Chinese are running the show, they're in bed with Silicon Valley. I mean, if it wasn't for President Trump stopping Huawei, these people are spying on everything. We have to stop them. They are really right, because the Chinese is the dragon of the apocalypse. So.
Question.
Leo, I have a question. What do you see as far as the association of Islam, as far as Islamism, with Europe, especially as far as not everybody understands theocratic Islam versus social Islam or religious Islam, since it's a theocracy, it's a religious government. As far as the people like Angela Merkel essentially acting as the role of a dhimmi, accepting protection of Islam in order to allow a mass migration of Muslim supremacists into Europe, which a lot of people don't understand, which is hijrah, which is an Islamic vision, going into the abode of war. Is there any correlation that you've seen in Europe as far as they're essentially submitting to Islam to be dhimmis, to be protected in their regions of power in order to facilitate this mass migration to the EU?
There is a plan. This plan is called the Kalergi plan, and it was devised by a guy called Count Kalergi. He was half Austrian, half Japanese. And 100 years ago, he laid the foundations for Europe and for an organization called Pan-Europa. And Angela Merkel is one of those people who received the Kalergi Award, which is given. They give a yearly award also dedicated to Kalergi. But the interesting thing here about Islam arriving into Europe and not being stopped, Angela Merkel used to be a Stasi agent. She was a communist agent. She's an agent. She's very good friends with Putin. She's very good friends with Putin. Now, the big problem here, and I'm in a bad post, I would like Americans to really meditate on this, because this is a very big problem, and Americans should understand that they don't have much time before this can become an even bigger problem. Problem here, you know, if this situation continues in Europe, Europe is going to arrive in a state of chaos and of civil war and arrest. Okay? They want that. And why they want that? Because these agents who are working for Russia are facilitating this chaos, because sooner or later the Russians are going to be invited to come back and liberate again Europe, like it happened in the First and Second World War. But the difference this time, and this I heard directly from a general of the GRU in Moscow, and he said it very plainly. He said, the Europeans called us for the First World War, and we ended up being kicked us and a revolution. The second time we freed Berlin, and we end up now in Nazi. The third time, we're gonna come in Europe and we're gonna occupy it. So either the Americans wake up now, or otherwise Europe is lost. So that is why they're facilitating this whole thing of the Nazis coming in. Understand? They want millions of Nazis to come into Europe, destroy the churches, destroy the culture. That's why, you know, France has been hundreds of churches that have been burned, destroyed. Nobody says anything. Because they are inspiring civil unrest. Because sooner or later, a bunch of people are going to start seeing more. Probably more in France than Iraq, because in Iraq they have been castrated of any dignity after the Second World War. I'm sorry, after the upper hand upside down Mussolini, that was the end of Iraq. Then Italy, oh yes, sorry. But Germany has risen back after the unification of Eastern and West Germany. That's it. We lost when the two Germanies came back together. It's in the moment, you know, and that was the moment in which the new world order really, whoa, they really got. You know, in fact, we started seeing George Bush saying, you know, he was like, the new world order, wow, 1991, you know, they defeated the Soviet Union. That was the moment. We have to be very careful because otherwise we can have bases in Europe as Americans, but those bases are not safe.
What about now?
So we have to be helping Europeans to stop the situation now, or otherwise we lose Europe, and in turn we're going to lose our peace here in America. Because at one point, they're going to call on America to help them, as they usually do in Europe. Right? Every time, it's the same thing. It happened already two times. And it's going to happen again. Please come and help us. So, but this time it will be a bit more complex, the situation. So it's better to intervene now. But Barack Obama, that time that he was talking with he was talking with him in a very intimate way, remember? He was like, hey man, you gotta do business after I finish. Yeah man, let's do business. So that's it. Guys, John Podesta and his brother are Russian agents. And that's it. It's a Russian collusion, but it's all to do with the Democratic Party. And nobody's saying anything about it. Every day I have to put them as all these demented channels, ABC, and they were Russian Corona, we have to impeach the right, Man, these people are so impeached themselves. They're impeached in the head, they're impeached. It's a big problem they have, is first of all, they're impeached with their own head. The Democrats, the Democrats, big problem. When as a party you start to be possessed and you resemble a cow, you don't talk anymore like a political party. No, it's either my way or it's just... They're like Nazis. Nazis, that's what it is. It was socialist, national socialist. Well, good luck. I mean, they should just have as vice president Bernie Sanders and President Joe Biden. And that's it, guys. I'm gonna hide here in the mountains with a bunch of patriots because that's it. If these people become in power, I'm gonna have to hide again, even here in America. At least here in America, they have to wear. So that's how we hopefully get a good answer. But they are doing it to facilitate Russia. So let's wake up because Russia likes to play good chess games and they're very good at it.
So in terms of Islam here in our country, I mean, is there a good and bad Islam, or is, I mean, I understand, you ultimately have like a utopia, but is there a good and bad, or is there just...
The problem is you can be as good as you want, but if you throw a bunch of Muslims in Texas or in another place just because you want to integrate them, you can't integrate these people. They're not Israel. The problem is that when you join America, at least a few years ago, you have to embrace all the American values. Not that I have to defend myself in front of a lawyer because I'm the president of Italian Small Trump, who is the president. And he's active in the Democratic Party. No, it's like, ooh. And I have to fear him. Oh! I mean, it's really insane the way that things have gone. So, I mean, the values of an immigrant have to be the values of the country. Is embracing. I remember one thing about Norway that teaches me very much during many years in Norway. The Norwegians are a very socialistic in kind of country, but also very nationalistic. They are very nationalists, they are very Nazis. In fact, when the Nazis went to, during the Second World War, there was one country that was not invaded, it was Sweden. They had to invade Norway, so they paid the train ticket to go and invade Norway. So the Swedish are really the most Nazis of all, but those are like untouchable. You're really interested in what? Let's pay the ticket to go and invade Norway. It never happened in the history. But when they arrived in Norway, most of Norway, Trondheim, also, they opened the doors. Ooh, come! Hi! You know, they were all Nazis. So I understand one thing in Norway. Every year on the 17th of May, they all have to dress in red and go parade. Norway. That's it. And everybody has to do it. The Muslim, the Christian, the Com, everybody. They have to all parade. Actually, even the Hells Angels have to parade. And they're all... Imagine that. It's all happening every 17th of May. You go to Norway, you see it with your eyes. And they get integrated there because either you integrate or either these 2 meter tall Norwegians are like, boom. Yeah, I was like, boom. When I got arrested with espionage in Norway, I was pretty scared, man. These people are really scared, totally insane. And plus, they all had the same ring, because their form of Freemasonry is not like the other forms of Freemasonry. It's the Swedish Rite, it's very traditional. The action is practiced only in their languages, so nobody else can really understand what they say. And it's very Christian, but in reality, it's full of Satanists. So it's a very natural contradiction. Anyway, it's everybody's a member. So they all have this ring with 3 red crosses. One is outside, they're all outside these red crosses of the temples. And when you get these people, you see them and how they are. It wasn't like a normal scenario. It was like, wow, man, I'm the prisoner of a state which actually has given the Nobel Peace Prize to Barack Obama! Has given the Nobel Peace Prize to war manga like Barack Obama. I mean, I'm sorry for the Norwegian, but I have many good friends in Norway, and still now, but I feel sorry for them because Norway, the country, completely brainwashed. Imagine, they even give hundreds of thousands of dollars to the Clinton Foundation, including the Foundation of Free Wealth. They gave their own money from the state. Actually, even the Italian state gave some money to the Clinton Foundation. Why don't we investigate the fact that the Clinton Foundation has received not only money from private founders and donors, but also from... That's a big question, right? So, other question, guys?
You were talking about war. Right now it's kind of a strange time in history. We had two pretty obvious false flags happen, possibly by the military-industrial complex, and the whole world's kind of seeing that someone, whoever it is trying to start a war.
Yeah, but I
so
like
what do you think is going to happen with that?
I think that Trump did a great psychological warfare operation. I think that Trump is number one, really, because he had, okay, the military-industrial complex, and I'm sorry to be the vet post saying this, is unstoppable because of great interest. But Trump knew that very well, and they were trying to really get him into this war. So he went along with it, and he said, it's 150 people may die, I'm sorry, I'm not gonna do it. At that point, everybody was like, thrown apart, because you see, they were all wanting him to do it. So now Trump has done really something that really shows he's like a good grandfather, a good guy. No, I don't want to do it because it's 150 people who will actually die. Who cares if 180 million drones is dead or whatever? He actually has devalued human life more than a drone. So I think that this is a moment, really a turning point for the movement. Because after this, I think that a lot of Democrats will switch sides.
They should at least write us a check for the drone.
What do you think will happen?
They should at least write us a check for the drone.
Well, I mean, from Iran, of course, they should write a check for the drone. But don't understand, Iran has so many debts.
Obama gets plenty of money, huh?
Iran has already a mega debt in Russia. I don't know what it's about. Something like $5 billion. And then on top of that, there is a lot of other things that people don't know. So this proxy war between Sunni and Shiite Islam has been going on for 1,200 years. And that's, you know, the whole thing about either Iran, other Saudi Arabia, which is also Wahhabi, and all this confrontation that goes on. Guys, I mean, the Muslims, just they need to really get together and just chill out. Maybe smoke a big fat joint in California. Why don't you convert them to some flower power? I mean, the Muslims really need to get it. They're really a religion that hasn't gone forward, you see. They never had a central institution to reform them. What you were saying, the social Islam. Islam also reaches the fact they have a moderate Islam. And it doesn't exist.
It doesn't.
No, yes, please, please.
I have a friend who is a... He's a Sunni Muslim, he's an economics professor, very staunch constitutionalist. He's one of my friends up in Pasadena, he's also a professor at his local college. His name is Hasim Hassan. And our biggest problem is being able to identify our Western train of thought on Islam, projecting onto Islam, and not listening to Islam. And then, like you just said, the moderate Islam doesn't exist. There's no moderate Islam, there's no extremist Islam. There are Islamists who are Muslim theocratic supremacists. They want Islam to be their government. And then there are secular Muslims. Secular Muslims who do not want, they want to practice their religion and be left alone, and they want to live under, say, our constitution, like my friend Hasim. And that is a hard distinction to get the Western mind to understand. Because we don't listen to the Muslims about who their enemy is.
It's a hard distinction also for the Muslim themselves.
It is for many of them. Because it's absolute.
Yeah, and also because I know this one thing is that is missing. Most of the Imams, it's like a priest. You know, the priests go to a seminar. Most of them have to study theology. They usually study not only the Bible, many books to become a priest. In Islam, an imam has maybe studied the Quran and never another book in his life. The majority of imams that at times recite these prayers, at times even without knowing them, just like it was in the old days with Latin, that some priests didn't really know, but they were reciting it. So I think that Islam is a real sluggish stuff that is barbaric. They are stealing the battle of the camels. That's the big problem, not with the modern people like your friend who are forced to get in the West and would like to see Islam embracing modernity. The problem is that Islam doesn't embrace modernity because it doesn't want to change, because in the end, when you go deep in their tradition, when you go actually in their countries, because they're all, one thing about the Muslims that they have to understand, they never abandon the connection with their own country. It's not like here, here in America, a lot of the immigrants from Europe or from other parts of the world, in the end, after 3 or 4 generations, they lose a connection or something. Maybe they can go and visit, their hometown or their great-great-grandmother in Italy once or whatever. But instead, in the Muslim world, they have a connection which is alive even to this community, Even if their great-grandfather immigrated, they still have the cousin of the cousin, and they are only then connected.
Or if the Moors were kicked out of Spain, and they still want to free Alan Dallas.
That's another thing. Spain. Spain is a little bit like Sicily. The strange thing about Spain and Sicily these days is that these two places have become socialist and communist. The ex-governor, the former governor of Sicily that was just defeated a couple of years ago by a more conservative one, he used the money of the state, of the region of Sicily, to bleach his anus. Traditional Sicilians, the Don, the kissing area. No, the guy. No problem with that. But to actually use the money in the Sicilian region to bleach your anus, it's a bit too much. And then you have to be intercepted with a phone call so they can expose it. That is even more embarrassing at the end, Whatever. And his name was Crochet, which means a little cross. Okay, our next question. Somebody have another question? Another problem with the terminating Sicily Spain is ex countries where there was a lot of Arabs and Moors, and I come from. In those days in Sicily, when they converted to Christianity, I still have the paintings, the old paintings in my family's house down in Italy. You see, the Moors giving back the keys of Sicily to the Normans, so to the guys who Christianized them. And all the Moors became churches. In fact, all the ex-mosques you see in Sicily are churches.
Lots of questions.
And is this when they left? So you're saying when the invasion of the Muslims left Spain, they gave the keys back?
No. In Sicily, it lasted from 9th to 12th century after Christ. There was 3 centuries as strong as the Moors are. But when they were defeated, they actually symbolically gave the keys back, they left, and the Islamic religion was never practiced again in the whole land.
So they lost and left.
That's it. You couldn't, it's not like now, everything is open. Nowadays, instead, we go in the reverse way. In the north of Italy, they have started selling churches of the Catholic Church to make mosques. And the Vatican last year has given their own permission so the churches can be sold for that purpose, which is, I think, it's
really. Now I saw the Pope with an imam kissing.
Well, of course, but not only that, he made a lot of meetings, he went to Morocco, and the King of Morocco, the Pope went to the King of Morocco, but the King of Morocco is the biggest pervert and Satanist on the books. And,
Satan is Satan controlling the weak minded.
Satan controls the weak mind, unfortunately. But I think that in order to not have the weak mind, we need to have the possibility for this gadget here, the artificial intelligence controller, to not interfere with our reality. So we need to stay in control of our brain, if possible. I hope that this is clear for everybody. Other questions? I think we answered everything. Thank you very much for coming here today.
So basically, I just want to thank everybody who came out. We got done about time we said we were going to get done, around 6 o'clock. I just want to thank you all for showing up. The catering was wonderful. Leo and his wonderful wife, Kara, I appreciate you, Mr. Turner. Running for Assembly District 1. We have to support conservatives. They're going to help our country. We have to fight back. Thank you all who brought your children out. I appreciate you. Thank you very much. And formerly you. Spread the word, share the links, and donate to your veterans, guys. Appreciate you. Thank you all very much for coming on.